Hi, my name is Courtney Davis, and this is my EFD 552, Dr. Kaiser, Diversity Plan for Benjamin Russell High School, and I did it in collaboration with my partners, Ms. Kelly Duke and Ms. Regina Ogletree. And focusing on Benjamin Russell, we had to go ahead and come up with what is diversity, and this is my team's definition for it. First of mine, I said that diversity is the ability just to have an open mind and understand that everyone is in some way, shape, form, or fashion, like each other and different, and also accepting those truths that each individual is going to be embraced by their differences, and that we are to celebrate those differences, knowing that they're all needed in the element of diversity. One of my classmates said that diversity refers to equal importance and value among differences in physical characteristics, situations, and ideas that make individuals unique and interesting. And the last one said that came with the acronym. Basically, she said that different individuals valuing each other regardless of skin color, intellect, and talent, and also years that can be experienced with your life. And examples of diversity can be in race, religion, it can be in socioeconomic status, because all of them come from, meaning the service, the students that we service come from different economics classes, and we'll talk about that later. And it's also found in language, gender, and age. When it comes to children and poverty issues, what are the issues that we really see when it comes to poverty-stricken children that we teach and we have to service? The seven differences between children from low-income and also middle-class students, they consist of the following reasons. And it says that students from low-income households, generational poverty, even situational poverty, given the circumstance, they struggle with school and engagement in the learning process because of seven reasons. They are health and nutrition, because some of them come from homes where they're not getting that, and the only source of food that they do have is from school. That's why we had to implement at Benjamin Russell a breakfast program to make sure that they start the day with breakfast so that they're more apt to learning and their attention span is up. Vocabulary, and that'll get into the hidden cues of each economic status or class. Effort, when there's not a lot of expectation given at home, the effort is not there as well, because kids look at education, especially from the poverty-stricken or low economic status, to say that, oh, it's something that they aspire to do, but it's not attainable, or they don't have hopes in getting it. Hope and growth mindset. You have to come with the mindset to learn. So if you don't have the aspiration and already that support from your parents or that home life, it's hard to really just come to school with a mind that I can grow or I can get to somewhere where I see every day, beyond what I see every day. Cognition, those cognitive skills that they're lacking, and that's from birth on up. Neglect is one thing. Also being able to get into early childhood services. Another thing, relationships, that's parents with teachers. It says it's not the environment that at home that really affects you the most, but it's also the teachers and the experience that you have with those teachers. They can make the world of difference for a student. And then the stress levels of kids as well. All those taking play with their academic achievement. How poverty affects children. These are some of the things that I found, and also with collaboration phone, via email, and also we use airtime and FaceTime to go ahead and get this project done. Emotional and social challenges. Students from poverty, they have more emotional and also social behaviors and challenges. They have acute and chronic stressors, and I know we have found that through also some of the poverty stricken or poverty training that we've got from professional development throughout the year. We saw that chronic stress is one of the problems, and those are the experiences they've had since childhood that lead to chronic stress, and it leads to different things like depression. Cognitive lags, like I said, they lack the cognitive ability to learn, really. Health and safety issues also affects on school and behavior performance. When it comes to absenteeism, also their attention span is shorter, much shorter than somebody coming from a stable home and stable environment. Concentration is lacking as well, and also reduced motivation, like I said, they don't have that growth mindset. Increases the likelihood of depression, because all the things that they face on the outside mask what we try to do on the inside of the school corridors, I'll say. And also it has shown effects that it reduces neurogenesis, which is the growth of new brain cells. And that is because because of the acute chronic stressors. All right. How poverty affects children even further out. The brains of infants, it says that they're hardwired for only six emotions. That's going to be joy, anger, surprise, disgust, sadness, and fear. Children raised in poverty without a strong, reliable primary giver, it could be a parent or it could be a grandparent. Whether it has to be somebody that's going to be that support for them. If they have that, it can mask all those chronic stresses if you get to them earlier. Some of the behaviors that you might have affecting their achievement is going to be acting out behaviors, and they never really developed the language for negotiation. They either had to act as a parent or they had to act as an adult, and they never really developed their child voice. So when a teacher is maybe trying to discipline a kid from poverty, what they get is back sassiness, and really it's just instead of showing weakness, they'll come back at you with the adult language that they never learned, which is a child language that they really need to communicate with adults. Gaps in politeness and social graces, like I just said, they never develop the language of negotiation, which is the adult language. Inappropriate emotional responses and less empathy for others because they really are not able to look outside of themselves and see another person's situation with so much going on in their life. Effective measures taken. There can be effective measures taken, talking with my group to increase the success of poverty-stricken children. Some of those things are going to be focusing on attention and focus skills, working on short-term and long-term memory, sequencing and processing skills, and working on that thing that we call working memory. There's a lot of things that we found even in our poverty training to where you can implement in your classroom and work on their processing skills and sequencing skills and social skills as well, because a lot of them are introverts, they're not extroverts, and the more you do in class to help them with this, it'll help them in their academic achievement as well, because you have to talk as well. And this is saying that we have to bring them from low expectations to high expectations, even for themselves, because that's where they lack. They don't have any self-esteem in most cases because it's never been built. To go ahead, these are some in-school things that we can do. Embody respect. Always give them respect, even when they don't even deserve it, because if they see that somebody genuinely cares, in most cases, they'll, like they say, jump over hurdles and hoops, through hoops for you as a teacher. Embedded social skills. You have to teach them about formal language or talking in the formal register, because most of the kids that we teach, they talk in the casual register. We have incorporated like student-led conferences to work on their 21st century skills, as well as we do a lot of reading strategies, turn and talk, just to get them talking. And it's helped a lot, I think so. Or it's helping if they want to be helped. Being inclusive, always keeping them in on the process of learning, making sure that they're paying attention at all times. Empowering students, you can give them affirmations. There's a lot of things they're working on. Some of my colleagues are working on as well with teaching them about empathy and showing being grateful for something, being optimistic, and giving them that self-hope that they need. And providing hope and support. Like I said, teachers are the most important factor when it comes to children that have not come from stability, to make sure that they can see that there's a light at the end of the tunnel or there's hope in getting to a better life. And recruiting and training the best staff you can. That's why we have to have highly qualified and also those teachers that really care about those students and their success. The target group for our project, our diversity plan, which it gathered information from the Ventarosa scores, ACT science scores, Elementary School, and then Baggett Elementary School. Our target group was African-American male student achievement versus their counterparts being every other ethnicity, depending on the school that we had. And you see, in Benjamin Russell, just because this is the school I teach at, the ethnicity that we have, and then the percentage of the students, with whites we have 59%, blacks coming in second at 37.6%, we have Hispanics and Asian, and then we also have some biracial children as well. But you'll see that most of our demographic is made up of white and black. And also in this pie chart, you'll see the ethnicity or demographic of Benjamin Russell as well. So there's already a disparity kind of when you see white and black. And then just we have some diversity when it comes to Hispanic and Asian cultures as well. So focusing on the standardized assessment, the data that I got from Benjamin Russell from school year 15, 16 and 17, the class, those graduating classes, I was looking at four levels of proficiency when it came to the ACT. Students scoring in 16 and below, it was level 1, 17 and 22 was level 2, and 23 to 28, level 3, and 4 being a 29 and above to a 36. And what we were trying to do is move those African American males and their achievement with the incorporation of Newzella, which was a reading literacy program that's online. Also Mastery Prep, which we just took the ACT for our juniors this year, incorporating them as bell ringers and quizzes within our class. And also with strategic teaching that we do at Benjamin Russell. So in the first year, 2014-15, you'll see that 29 students, black males, scored in level one, level red. Level one is in red, level two is in green, brown, and level, it's like a tan color. Level three is in green, and level four is in four. We had no black males in level four proficiency. You'll see that we had one white female and four white males. So there is a disparity when it comes to those black males. Even when it comes to black females, you'll see that more black females scored between a 23 and 28, where we had 3 to 6. So there's a ratio when it comes to those black males being last on achievement, the achievement curve. All right, 2015-16, you'll see now that we have less black males in level one, meaning they scored 16 below. Now you have them scoring 17-22, and they're almost meeting benchmark. And I think, what is benchmark for science? 23 or 22? 23. So now you have 5 students. So it has gone up, and we're seeing that because of our strategic teaching, because of the inclusion or incorporation of Mastery Prep, and also some of the quizzes that comes with Mastery Prep and Newzella, you're increasing that literacy and you're increasing the skills that need to be honed in on. And the last year, right before this school year, 2016-17, now you see it's way less black males that are in level one. You have more of them, 13 of them, scoring a level two proficiency, meaning they scored 17-22. You actually have 4 in 23 to a 28, and you have 1, which in those 2 years before, you didn't see any scoring 29 and above. So we are seeing an increase on their science scores when it comes to ACT. The conclusions, like I said, it was a collaboration between Miss Kelly Duke and Regina Ogletree. We found that with including some of these affirmations, including some of these strategies that we talked about, giving those students support, taking out time to even just help them with tutoring, and I know a lot of my colleagues do that as well. We said that we want to see an increase on a more longitudinal base that we can keep up with. I know on Newzella we can keep up with their progress. So with including these 3 schools, we want to see the African-American males versus their counterparts, that the achievement gap closes. And I believe that we can do that with professional staff that we have at Benjamin Russell. Also, with just caring for those students and looking at where they are and seeing how we need to move them to a higher achievement in academics. So my partners were Kelly Duke, and she was from Medina Elementary High School, or elementary school. And she used the Ames Webb math scores data to check African-American males' achievement to Hispanics. I think that was the only diversity she had at her school. Baggett Elementary had a little more diversity at hers. She had Hispanic and Asian, just like Benjamin Russell. And she used milestone math scores. So that is my presentation. And before we end, I just wanted to talk to some of my colleagues to see, do they agree with some of the things that we're doing as far as like addressing poverty and addressing diversity at our school to achieve or help minorities or different ethnicities achieve higher?
Well, I do. I think one of the good things that you said was how the conversational language and the social norms and politeness, those are things that maybe students from poverty sometimes don't, they lack those skills because they're not exposed to those skills as much. And so I think that by opening up the doors, not just to that, that's also going to open up the doors, academically speaking, for their future preparations in college and scholarships and opportunities. And so I think all of that plays a role in increasing those scores in that specific demographic.
Anybody else got anything to add? All right.